Good morning.
Good morning.
It is great to see you today. Thanks for being here. And it's the second Sunday of November already. The good news is we got five Sundays in November. So we get to stretch this month out just a little bit. Wasn't it great having Bob Thomas with us last Sunday?
It was great to see so many people move to make some important decisions in their life last Sunday, and so continue to pray for one another about those things. Thank you for your generosity towards Bob's ministry last weekend. We'll be sending him a check this week for $1,500, all right, that you all gave. So that's important. Thank you so much for doing that. Shell and I had an opportunity to get away for 5 days, and we went to the state of Colorado. And we spent 2 days in Estes Park. And how many of you remember the movie The Shining? Yeah, we were given a room on the fourth floor of the Stanley. We moved to the third floor. Not for those reasons. It's just the first room was a little small, all right? And so we moved to a little bigger one. But we primarily went to Estes Park so that we could see Mrs. Thomas. Those of you who've been around New Hope for quite a while, you're familiar with Torchbearers, and we used to have a regular speaker come, Major Ian Thomas, who would do a Bible conference almost every year for 7 or 8 years. He went home to be with the Lord 7 years ago, and his wife Joan is now 94, and she is still living in Estes Park, Colorado, at the Ravencrest Chalet, where the Torchbearer Center is. And we had afternoon tea. She's British. She's from England. And so we had afternoon tea with Mrs. Thomas, and she was just absolutely delightful. Her long-term memory is pretty good. Her short-term memory is, we answered the same 5 questions about 4 times, all right? But we had, apart from that, we had a wonderful visit. About 2.5 hours we got to spend with her, and an added bonus was her son Chris, who is now the general director for Torchbearers International. There's 24 small Bible schools all around the world, and some of the most incredible places that you have ever seen. And now her son Chris Thomas is providing direction for that ministry, and he had been in India but came home a day early. So we ended up having the opportunity to spend that time with Chris as well. So it was beautiful there. Then we went to Colorado Springs for 3 days, and I got to ride the cog train to the top of Pikes Peak. Okay, it's 14,110 feet at the top. We did this because we were supposed to go on vacation in September, and my stents prevented that, so we didn't get to go. So we went to Colorado instead. I'm in this cog train at about 12,100 feet, and I'm thinking, I wonder if I should be doing this with stents in my heart. Hadn't even thought about it till that moment, and I thought, well, not much I can do about it now because they're not going to let me out. And they're not going to turn around. So, but you know what? My heart worked just fine at 14.1, all right? It was 6 degrees when we got to the top, 32-mile-an-hour winds, and snowing. So the chill factor was minus 13. It was a little brisk at the top of Pike's Peak. There's a building up there that you get to look around and spend money in if you want to. And then they bring you back down. But it's just awesome to see God's creation from that perspective. It's a perspective you don't get very often. And then some of you, there'll be a few of you in here who'll remember a woman named Yolanda Peasley. All right? And Bernice, I know, will remember. Dad? Anyway, she sends her greetings. We got to have a cup of coffee. Yolanda now lives in Colorado Springs, and we had the opportunity to have a cup of coffee with her. So anyway, it is great to be back. If you are visiting New Hope today and this is your first time here, welcome. It's a privilege to have you here. There are some Connect cards in the pew in front of you. I would love for you to fill one out, put it in the offering bag, and next week through the mail, we'll send you information of what goes on around New Hope Church. We promise not to harass you or annoy you, but hopefully answer most of your questions you would have about the church. Hey, last Wednesday night was our first choir practice for Christmas, all right? They learned 2 numbers. Going to be a different Christmas program there, opening number choir, closing number choir, big pieces in between. It's called Christmas, It's Personal. And you are going to hear either solos, duets, or small groups, all right? Sing things in between, songs that are very personal to them about the Christmas season. And so first rehearsal was last Wednesday night. Here's what they need. Men, Okay, Milos, I asked Milos, how'd it go? He said, we need some men. So if you can carry a tune, you don't even have to read music, but you can carry a tune. They'll hit the piano for you. Randy, right? Randy, you'll give them the...
Even if you can't carry a
tune. Okay, they'll give you a bucket. They'll give you a bucket to carry it in, all right? So they're looking for some men, all right? Just two songs, not hard this year. Two songs, you'll be able to do just fine. They'd love to see you Wednesday night, 6:45. 6:30 right here in this building, all right? Hey, this Tuesday, senior luncheon. Listen carefully. If you've never been to a senior luncheon, this is not a retired luncheon. You don't have to be retired to go to senior luncheon. 55 or older, okay? 50. Some of the people who started that are now in the senior luncheon, they started at 55. They weren't retired. Now they're retired. Okay? So it's okay. This is the first one to show up to if you've never been to one before. This is Thanksgiving dinner. This is turkey. This is Grandma Roland's dressing. This is amazing. This is always a wonderful event. It's at noon on Tuesday. If you're going to come, bring a side dish or a dessert. Okay, bring a side dish or a dessert, and it's in the bridge. They would love to see you at noon on Tuesday. Today, from 3 to 5:30, over in the bridge and on the pavilion, is our appreciation and gratitude party for Gene's years of ministry to and for and through New Hope Church. So this is a come-and-go event. Come at any time between 3 and 5:30 and express your gratitude. I have had folks ask me what would make Gene feel appreciated. A Monte Cristo Excalibur Maduro. Okay? I'm just letting you know, okay? He would feel greatly appreciated by that. Never mind. Next Sunday, there'll be an informational meeting at the 10:45 service over in the office. If you have any interest in being an elder at New Hope, or if somebody has asked you, would you consider being an elder at New Hope, if you would attend that meeting next Sunday at 10:45, a lot of information will be given and questions will be answered. The Widow's Lunch Brunch is also next Sunday at 12:30 at the Japanese Gardens. There's more information in your bulletin. You can check that out. Last Sunday morning, our youth pastor, Chris Bishop, shared with us what they're going to be doing in the high school program, all right, as they approach the Christmas season. It's called Advent Conspiracy, and there's four points, all right, to Advent Conspiracy. Let's see if I can remember this off the top of my head. Number one, worship fully. Number two, spend less. Number three, give more. And see, those two kind of go, all of them go together, but if you spend less, you have more to give, right? All right, so give more. And number four is love all. And so those are the four tenets that they're going to be talking about and actually doing out of our high school kids from the last Sunday of Thanksgiving until Christmas Sunday. And so they're going to do a kickoff on the last Sunday of November on a Sunday night. Information's in your bulletin. I believe it's at 6:30. It'll either be in the bridge, depending on crowd, or be in here, all right? Or maybe we'll go in there and we'll pipe it on big screen in here, okay? We'll do it reverse. But anyway, it's going to be a night of contemporary worship as we head into that season. Worship fully that will lead into those next three tenets for the rest of it. So in show of great support for our high school kids and what they're doing, we might learn something as well. Prayer requests. Continue to pray for Brandy Walker. She's sitting right up here on the front row with us as they work through all the various issues that come with health concerns, insurance concerns, and opportunities for them to take care of that tumor, which is in her eye. So continue to pray for her. Joni Jarbo Anderson's daughter, cancer has spread into her neck. If you would remember to pray for her. Arlene Brobst, and I want to read a note that Arlene sent to me today. Arlene and her husband Jim have been regulars, normally attend our 8 o'clock service, is where they were this morning. We shared with you last Sunday that she had been diagnosed with cancer in the lung and the jaw. There is a bit more information now that they didn't have, and let me share what she wrote to me. She said, Pastor Tim, I will begin this note with the same sentence we used when telling our three adult children the news. Jim and I will walk this journey hand in hand, trusting God the way we have through 55 years of marriage. I almost don't care what follows, after that opening. That's what you long for in a life with Christ as you face the challenges in this world. Then she says, I have a very rare form of cancer. It is a tumor in the salivary gland. Only 10 people in a million will develop this type of cancer. Research is limited, and there is no specific chemo treatment. Once the tumor has formed, the cancer can go into the bloodstream throughout your body, as it has in mine already. This is a stage 4 level cancer. After further tests, Dr. Gupta will decide what mixture of chemo might be best, and this may or may not slow the progress. This is not the news that we wanted to hear, but our trust and our faith is solid in God. We know that God is in control of the plan that He has for our lives. We need to let Him guide us each step of the way. And so that is the prayer request for Jim and Arlene Brobst as they face this challenge in their life. I want you to remember some families who are in need of God's comfort and attention over these next few weeks. The Dane Wildy family. The Wildys live right behind our church. We share a back fence with them, one house over. And his 72-year-old dad, who was in great health, died very unexpectedly last weekend. His services were this past weekend here in town. Debbie Brown Reno, her family and friends, they're good friends of the Littles. Her brother passed away, and the services were here yesterday. The Alexander family, it's a service that Jean did on Thursday here at the church, if you would be remembering them. And then the Nicholas Williams family, Robert did a service in Dinuba for them. And so all of these families are in need of God's care and comfort at this particular time. So we would appreciate you remembering them. I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward if they would please and prepare to wait on us as we have our morning tithes and offering. Would you join with me as we... You okay?
Yeah.
All right. Good, yeah. Always a little scary there. You can come out now. Milo's coming to help you up. Okay, you're good? Yeah. Okay, all right. You know, it looks like you've gotten a little sun this week. Your face is a little more red than normal. So, let's pray. Father, thank you for comic relief. Sometimes after a list of prayer concerns, comic relief is good for us. The Bible says that laughter is good medicine for the soul. And so, Father, I pray that you'll give us much to laugh and smile about in life. Most of all, Father, I'm thankful for your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. For it is because of him, it is in him, it is by him, it's through him that we have the life that we have today. Father, a life that is filled with purpose, that is not selfish but is selfless. A life that is filled with power that doesn't come from our own resources but it comes from the one who lives within us. And a life of promise, knowing that death does not hold the last and final word for us. But Father, it simply is the gateway to the fulfillment of all of your promises in our lives. And so we say thanks for all that you have provided for us. We trust you with the needs of those who are facing physical challenges here in this life. We trust you with the needs of those who are battling discouragement, maybe even depression as a result of death or loss of a loved one. May they find encouragement and hope in you, and that death no longer has to have a hold of fear on their lives. Lord, you know the uncertainty of those who've walked into this building today. There are some who are here for reasons we have no idea, but you do. And Father, we don't need to know. But what we do need to share is the sufficiency of Jesus Christ, that this is not a religion for us to practice, but this is a relationship for us to participate in. This is a relationship for us to receive love, and it's a relationship for us to share love. This is a relationship for us to experience the incredible life that someone wants to offer to us, and that is the life of your Son, the Lord Jesus. So we thank you for those opportunities today. We commend to you our needs, knowing that, Father, you always provide. And so as we give today on the basis of your blessings in our life, we give not out of force or compulsion, but Father, we give out of a deep love and appreciation for you. And Father, as we give, may you provide leadership for how your resources should be used for your kingdom's work in this world. We trust you for all this in the awesome name of Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. So all the music today came from a list that was given, all right, to Milo, that were some of your favorites. Milo was right. He's heard you say, well, I can't wait for the worship team to do Sharp Dressed Man. And they found your favorite guitarist, all right, to come and play today. And so the afternoon is to celebrate Gene's 15 years that have been here. Now, he's still working, all right? He's got till the end of the year. We're holding him to it, all right? But this is our day. We didn't want it this day to get lost in the excitement of Thanksgiving and Christmas. We wanted this to be a day that would be special for you. And so hopefully that Sharp Dressed Man is part of that. Gene, also from the church board and from the congregation, this comes from the general fund and contributions that were given. A special gift to you for your 15 years of service here. This is a check for $5,000 from the church family to you. Yep. God bless you. Use it well. I love you. Not enough.
Thank you all very much. Please be seated.
And actually, I want it back because I have to do it again next service. So I don't have another one to give you. Oh, it's not enough. It is not enough. But anyway, okay. Okay. Gene, now you know why you have to stay through the music next service.
Yeah.
Okay, all right. Whoops, I think I knocked something of Jeff. Oh, right. You play a guitar with that?
Yeah.
All right. Amazing. Amazing. Yeah. While you're back there, check to make sure nobody's back there that can fall down. All right. After Sharp Dressed Man, how do you preach, man? That is a tough one. That is a tough one. If you were asleep, you're awake now, right? All right. Awesome. I invite you to turn your Bibles, if you would, please, to the Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. The Gospel of Luke, chapter 17. I want to read verses 11 through 19. Luke was written by a physician. I think that's particularly important, particularly in the passage that we're going to read. He understood a lot about medical needs and medical concerns of his day. And so we can have confidence in what he has to say here. But Luke, chapter 17, verses 11 through 19. Let's read them. Now on his way to Jerusalem, Jesus traveled along the border between Samaria and Galilee. As he was going into a village, 10 men who had leprosy met him. They stood at a distance. Why? Yeah, they had leprosy. You see, the rules of the day, the laws of the land at that time, if you had leprosy, you could not get any closer than 100 feet from healthy people. You had to stay a minimum of 100 feet away. And in fact, you had to yell, unclean! Unclean! And so from 100 feet away, this group of 10 men, remember, on the border of Samaria, where Samaritan lives, Samaritans were what in their culture? It's a term we don't like to use today. They were half-breeds, okay? Their genetic background was, in their terminology, polluted. So on this border of Samaria and Galilee, Jesus was walking, and 10 men yelled from at least 100 feet away, Jesus, Master, have pity on us. When he saw them, he said, go show yourself to the priest. Sounds a little weird, doesn't it? Lord, have mercy on us. Show pity on us. Go show yourselves to the priest. If you don't know the culture, it sounds very rude. It sounds almost like he's saying, hey, don't bother me. Go see the priest. It's kind of like when somebody might ask you about how can I be saved, and then you say, go ask the pastor. That's not what Jesus was saying. You see, in the culture of that time, though they did not have a cure for leprosy, but on occasions, on rare occasions, there would be folks who the symptoms would all go away. If they had any hope of being restored back to their community, back to their families, they would have to go before the priest and be determined clean by him, and then they could return home. So in essence, what Jesus is saying to them is, hey, go see the priest and he'll let you go home again. And as they went, they were cleansed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, can you just imagine in your own head a moment? You're standing 100 feet away from Jesus and you yell, hey, have pity on us. And he says, go to the priest. And you turn and you head towards where the priests are. And as you're walking, you're looking at each other. And all of a sudden, the pockmarks and the swelling of your face, of each other's face, diminish. And your skin starts to be smooth, and you look at your hands, and all of the broken open sores on your hands close up, and your skin becomes smooth or old looking. And you go, wow. Because that's what, on the way from point A to point B, they were healed. One of them, when he saw that he was healed, he came back, praising God in a loud voice, and he threw himself at Jesus' feet, and he thanked him. And notice what Luke adds. And he was a Samaritan. I suggest to you the other 9 were probably Jews. There'll be a reason for that in just a moment. The only reason there would have been a blend of Jews and Samaritans, you remember they're on the boundary of Galilee and Samaria. But if they all hadn't had leprosy, they wouldn't have been together. You see, the Jews accepted the Samaritan accepted the Jews because what bound them together was their leprosy. Jesus asked, were not all 10 cleansed? In other words, hey buddy, didn't the others get healed too? Where are the other 9? Was no one found to return and give praise to God except this foreigner? Now do you see why I think the other 9 were probably Jews? Yay. Jesus said, just the one foreigner is the only. The others who should have known better didn't, but the one who we wouldn't give any credence to knowing better did. And then he said to him, rise, go. Your faith has made you, NIV says, well, King James says, whole. We'll come back to that in a minute. One Thanksgiving season, a family was seated around their table looking at the annual holiday bird. From the oldest to the youngest, they were going to express their praise in prayer. When they came to the 5-year-old in the family, he began his prayer by looking at the turkey and expressing thanks to the turkey, saying although he had not tasted him yet, he knew he would taste good. After that rather novel expression of gratitude, he began with a more predictable line of credits, thanking his mother for cooking the bird and his father for buying the turkey. But then he went beyond that. He joined together a whole hidden multitude of benefactors, linking them with cause and effect. He said, I want to thank you for the checker at the grocery store who checked out this bird. I want to thank the grocery store people who put it on the shelf. I want to thank the farmer who made the turkey fat. I want to thank you for the man who made the feed. I want to thank you for those who brought the turkey to the store. Using his little Columbo-like mind, he traced the turkey all the way from its origin to his plate. And then at the end, he solemnly said, did I leave anybody out? His 2-year-old brother, embarrassed by this proceeding, said, what about God? Solemnly and without being flustered, the 5-year-old said, I was about to get to him. I wonder why we wait to thank God last rather than first. Maybe that was the attitude of the other 9. We'll get to him someday. But the one said, no. Gratitude for what he's done for me cannot and will not wait. Most of us are familiar with the traditional story of Thanksgiving, where William Bradford of Plymouth Rock proclaimed a day of Thanksgiving to celebrate the survival of the Pilgrims in their second year in this new world, as well as for the abundant harvest that they had reaped with the aid of the Indians that were there. However, most people don't know that the first American Thanksgiving did not occur in 1621 with a group of Pilgrims who shared a feast with friendly Indians. The first recorded Thanksgiving actually took place in Virginia 11 years earlier. And it was not with a feast. You see, the winter of 1610 at Jamestown had reduced a group of 409 settlers to just 60. The survivors had prayed for help without knowing how or where or when the help might come. But they thanked God. When help arrived, it came in a ship that was filled with food and supplies from England. And a prayer meeting was held to give thanks to God for his provision. You would think that after seeing so many of their loved ones die due to the hardness of the new world, they would not feel very thankful. However, the opposite was true. They realized they had much, much to be grateful for. I'm somewhat convinced that particularly us in 21st century American culture don't realize how blessed we are. Until my first trip to Africa, I did not realize how blessed I am. When I saw small children, when I saw 20-year-olds who looked like they were 50, and 40-year-olds who looked like they were 100, when I saw the huts that they lived in, and I saw the bare minimum of nourishment that they had to eat, and yet, when they had embraced the love of Christ and you could see the radiant smile on their face and the contentment with the meager resources they had, I realized I had a lot to learn about gratitude. We often don't realize how thankful we should be until what we have is threatened to be taken away. You see, I believe it's good and it's fitting that as Christians, we ought to celebrate Thanksgiving not just one time a year, but we ought to celebrate the attitude of Thanksgiving really every day in which we live. For God has certainly been good to every single one of us. Someone once said that gratitude is the source of all other Christian virtues. Since that's not in the Bible specifically, I'm not sure it's 100% true, but I believe it's pretty dang true. Ted Watson used to say that thanks is the language of faith. That when we can go to God in advance of seeing our needs met and we can say, thank you, God, that you provide, that we are expressing faith in advance. And if that be the case, then perhaps we need to reason that ingratitude may be the source of all or at least many of our faults and our problems as well. When we begin to take for granted what God has done for us, then we become calloused and filled with pride, and then God can no longer use us effectively. For a Christian, every day ought to be the day of thanksgiving and gratitude. In this passage of Scripture that we've read together, there were 10 lepers who met Jesus, and they had a life-changing encounter with the Lord. Wasn't all 10 of their lives changed that day? We don't have any history about the other nine. We got just this little glimpse of this one guy. But all of them, life was going to be different for them from that moment on. When we break this story down to its simplest elements, I think this describes every Christian. I think this story is an allegory. It's a picture that we were outcasts from the kingdom of God on our way to certain death. And then we had a life-changing encounter with Jesus Christ. And while we should never look back on the pleasures of our sin, we should never forget where the Lord has brought us. The Old Testament prophet Isaiah in chapter 51, verse 1 says, "Listen to me, you who pursue righteousness and you who seek the Lord, look to the rock from which you were cut and look to the quarry from which you were hewn." In other words, look at where God brought you out from. Remember what God has done for you. Visit again in your mind the place where you first met God and you found His mercy and His grace. What is so significant about these lepers who were healed is that out of the 10, just one returned to say thanks. There were 9 who did not take the time to say thank you. If you were to infer the truth of this story on the general humanity, we would say that 9 out of 10 people never really paused to give thanks for what they have. One man named Charles Brown, this is not to be confused with Charlie Brown, all right, there really is a writer by the name of Charles Brown. He gave several suggestions as to why the other 9 never returned to give thanks. Keep in mind, these are only suggestions, but they do reflect a lot about our own human nature. Here's his list. He said, one waited to see if the cure was real. One waited to see if it would last. One said he would see Jesus sometime later. One decided that he never had leprosy at all. One said he would have gotten well anyway. One gave the glory to the priests. One said, oh, well, Jesus didn't do anything. One said any rabbi could have done it. And one said, well, I was already getting better. And then there was the one who returned to give thanks. And I want to talk for just a few minutes this morning about some truths in this passage that I hope will prompt all of us maybe to have a greater sense of gratitude towards God for all that He has done and for all that He has promised to finish in our lives. Number one, let's notice the leper's condition. Most of us have heard stories of leprosy during biblical times. It was a horrible disease to have. Not only was there the pain of the disease itself, but there was the stigma that went along with having this particular disease. I tried to imagine in my own mind, because you and I, we don't know a whole lot about leprosy today. It's pretty much non-existent in the culture of the world today. Little pockets here and there, but not much as it once was a horrible disease. And so I tried to imagine, okay, Tim, in our lifetime, those of us sitting in this room, what could we connect leprosy to? The closest thing I could come to was about 20 years ago. What we went through as a nation, as a world, literally, with the idea of HIV and AIDS. And let's be honest, the things that were said about leprosy way back when, it must be because of some sin that you have committed. Okay? The same thing was said about HIV and AIDS. And we know that that wasn't always the case. I remember the hysteria about how contagious everybody thought HIV and AIDS were. That same kind of hysteria existed about leprosy. Come to find out, leprosy really could only be passed on. It usually was from fluid of saliva that maybe was passed from one person to another. Okay? So if you spit on somebody, if you kissed somebody, if you drooled on somebody, all right, or you were helping to care for them, and that was normally, they've come to find out later, the way that leprosy was spread. It wasn't airborne, all right? Just by touching somebody wasn't a guarantee that you would get it. So try to imagine leprosy and AIDS. That's the closest kind of description that we could understand, get our head around. The Mosaic law pronounced a leper as being unclean. They were not fit to enter into the tabernacle or into the temple. to the place of public worship. They could no longer live with their families. They were required by the law of that day to live outside the city. The law required that they tear their clothes as a sign of extreme sorrow, that their faces be covered, and that they would cry out unclean anytime anybody came close to them. Their faces were hidden, represented that no form of intimacy could be known. In the Hebrew tradition, the face was seen as being the most intimate part. You could not truly know somebody until you could see their face. When the Jews were commanded to seek the face of God, they were commanded to seek His presence. And the same Hebrew word for face is the same word used for God's presence. You've heard me in times past when we talk about hell, the valley of Gehenna outside the city limits of Jerusalem. The valley of Gehenna was the garbage dump for the city of Jerusalem. That is where folks took, that was before garbage collectors, all right? That's before nice little trucks came by and picked up our stuff, all right? Carted off to who knows where, but guess what? People who drive a garbage truck, they have to take the garbage somewhere. They take it to a dump site. The dump site in Jerusalem back at that time was the Valley of Gehenna. And you would take all of your garbage and you would dump it over the side into this deep ravine, this place called the Valley of Gehenna. And because a fire got started to consume the garbage, all right, to get rid of the waste, the scripture said that fire went day and night in the Valley of Gehenna. It burned the trash that was dumped there continuously by the residents of the city. And guess who lived in some of the small caves in the sidewalls of the Valley of Gehenna? The lepers. You know why they lived there? Because as people dumped their garbage off, they could get food fragments. They could get clothing. They could get things to help their shelter. And they lived in the sidewalls of the Valley of Gehenna with this oppressive heat always coming up from the floor of the valley and surviving off the garbage of others. And that is the term that Jesus used when he talked about hell, the Valley of Gehenna. It's where lepers lived. Gehenna, hell. It's where those who've been destroyed by the leprosy of sin will live. To be a leper meant no intimacy with anyone, no friendship with anybody. You were isolated. You were outcast. Leprosy was regarded as a disease which the Jews supposed to be inflicted for the punishment of some particular sin, and to be more than other diseases, a mark of God's displeasure. If you were a leper, you lost everything, your family, your employment, your money, your resources. Note that verse 12 of Luke 17 describes these lepers as standing afar off. For the rabbinic tradition said that they had to stand 100 paces from anyone else. They could not even come close to Jesus. The reason I've spent so much time describing leprosy this morning is because it's an allegory of what sin and Satan wishes to do to every single one of us today. Eaton's Bible Dictionary says of the disease about leprosy, it said it was the outward visible sign of the innermost spiritual corruption. It was a picture of the emblem that starts small, but its gradual spread, its internal disfigurement, the dissolution little by little of the whole body of that which corrupts and degrades and defiles man's inner nature and renders us unacceptable to enter into the presence of a pure and holy God. What leprosy did to the body is what sin does to your life and mine. I'm not equating leprosy with sin, but there are important similarities between them. Like the leper, we too were isolated from true intimacy. Like the leper, we too were outcasts of the kingdom of God. Like the leper, we too were in the process of losing everything because of sin. And like the leper, we too are being destroyed by that which was in our bodies. And according to the book of Romans, Paul said, inside our bodies before Christ is the law of sin and death. Let's number two, notice the leper's cry. In verse 13, we are told as Jesus was about to enter the city that these lepers who had to stand afar off began to cry, "Jesus, Master, have mercy on us." And that was all they could do because no physician in their day, and remember Luke wrote this, he was a physician. No physician could heal them. No medicine could cure them. They were helpless before the onslaught of this deadly disease. We like to think that we are sufficient, that we are capable of handling life, but the truth is we are born helpless into this world and we are helpless to stand in the presence of sin and Satan. We stand condemned by our sin and we are totally helpless in the face of death. Romans 5, 6 says it this way, "For when we were without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly." In the Greek language that the New Testament was written in, to be without strength means to be totally helpless. Like these lepers, we were helpless to stop the destruction of sin in our lives, and all we can do is cry for mercy. Here, the word for mercy is aleo. Have mercy or compassion. Some of you have heard me give the difference between mercy and grace because often those two words get confused. So let me just say it again. Grace is getting what you don't deserve, and mercy is not getting what you do deserve. They're two sides of a coin. Very different, and yet they're twins. Grace is getting what I don't deserve. I don't deserve the love of God. I don't deserve heaven. I don't deserve mercy. That's grace. Mercy, on the flip side, is not getting what I do deserve. I do deserve hell. But because of grace, I'm not getting it. I do deserve punishment, but I'm not getting it. I do deserve the consequences of my own bad acts, but I'm not getting it. Why? Because Jesus took them for me on a cross 2,000 years ago. Remember that mercy is not getting what we deserve, and I believe that these men realized that they were sinners, and whatever they had received, they deserved. Yet now they are crying out for mercy, for relief from their torment. They are begging the Lord to have compassion on them, to help them in their moment of need. Their only hope was placed in Jesus Christ. Everything else had failed. Everything in their lives had now come down to this moment, to this encounter with Jesus Christ. Aren't you glad that when your only hope was placed in Jesus Christ, that He was more than enough? Jesus had compassion on them and He told them, go present yourselves to the priests. That's what the law commanded. The priests would inspect them, give them a clean bill of health so they could rejoin their communities and their families. You can find that in Leviticus 14, 2. Last of all, I want us to notice one leper's celebration. We are told that as they began their journey to the priests, they were cleansed and healed. What is significant is that out of the 10, there was one who acted differently than the rest. Huh. All of them were healed. All of them looked different on the outside. But only one was different on the inside. I suggest to you it's the difference between religion and a relationship. See, we can get religion and we can clean up the outside. People can notice, wow, I got a feeling these nine guys who got home, everybody got excited because physically they looked better. But inside, corruption still reigned. But the one... And isn't it interesting? He was a Samaritan. His insides had not been polluted by religion already. I suggest to you the nine Jews knew about religion. The Samaritan said, "My religion did nothing for me, but Jesus did." And he ran back. He glorified God. He gave thanks to Christ. To illustrate how we often fail to give the thanks that God deserves, let me use a story out of one of Chuck Swindoll's books to illustrate. This is a story of a man that Chuck had visited in a very dismal veterans hospital in Southern California. Chuck said, "The day I arrived to visit, I saw a very touching scene. This man had a young son, and during his confinement to the hospital, he had made a little wooden truck for his boy. Since the boy was not allowed to go into the ward and visit his father, an orderly had brought the gift down to the child who was waiting in front of the hospital on the steps with his mother." And as I read this story this past week, I know that what he said was absolutely true. Because Dad used to spend 2 weeks at the VA hospital here in Fresno when I was just an elementary age boy, first, second, third grade. He would go for 1 to 2 weeks because of the shrapnel that was in his spine, and he would go for a checkup and tests and things. And in those days, if you were under 12 or 15, you weren't allowed in the room. And so my mom and my much older sister got to go up to see Dad, and I didn't. I'll say that differently in the next service, all right? And I would wait down in the waiting room, and when they would come back down, then we would go outside to go to our car, and my mom would say, wait just a minute, and would stand there on the steps, and Dad would come to the window, and he would wave at me from the third or fourth story, wherever his room was, and he would wave at me, and for 1 or 2 weeks, that was the only time I would see my dad. So I knew the story was right on the money. He said the father was looking out the fifth floor window watching his son unwrap the present he had sent him. The little boy opened the package and his eyes got wide, and when he saw that wonderful little truck, he hugged it to his chest. Meanwhile, the father was walking back and forth, waving his arms behind the window pane, trying to get his son's attention. The little boy put the truck down and he reached up and he hugged the orderly and he thanked him for bringing the truck. All the while, the frustrated father was going through this dramatic set of hand motions trying to get his son to look up. And he said, it's me, son. I made that for you. I gave that to you. Look up here. You could almost read his lips as you read the story. Finally, the mother and the orderly turned the boy's attention up to the fifth floor window. It was then the boy cried out, oh, Daddy, Daddy, thank you. I miss you. Come home soon. Thank you for my truck. And the father stood in the window with tears of joy streaming down his face. And I wonder how much like that child we are. We forget to look up where the real source of our gift comes from. It's kind of like the boy in the opening story praying, oh, I was about to get to God. It took a mother and an orderly to point up. And you see, sometimes God wants to use you and me to tell others, look up, look up. That's where the source of our strength comes from. Why did this 1 out of 10 leper, why did he act differently? Here's the real meat of today's message. This is the sermon within the sermon. There are 3 distinctions between him and the other 9 fellas. I want you to notice the perception of gratitude. The Bible says, and one of them, when he saw that he was healed. The Bible says he noticed. Now, there was no doubt that they were healed, but there was something different. The Greek word you'd hear is the word eido, and it means to know, to see, or to perceive. This leper took the time to note that he had been blessed. He realized that something wonderful was happening to him. He was sensitive to the power of Christ working in his life. His perception had entirely changed. This is not of me. This is of God. There's an old Jewish story that helps to illustrate this point. There was a man who goes to the rabbi and he complains, my life is unbearable. There are 9 of us living in one room. What can I do? And the rabbi answers, take your goat into your room with you. The man was incredulous, but the rabbi insists, do as I say and come back in a week. A week later, the man comes back looking more distraught than before. We cannot stand it, he tells the rabbi. The goat is filthy. The rabbi then tells him, go home, let the goat out, and come back in a week. A radiant man returns to the rabbi a week later, exclaiming, life is beautiful. It's beautiful. We enjoy every minute of it now that there's no goat, only 9 of us in a room. You see, the situation was the same as it was to begin with, but now his perception has changed. He realized he was blessed to begin with. Do we really perceive the ways that God has blessed us? The devil will do his best to keep our minds off the blessings of God. He will constantly tell us how bad we have it, how everything is going wrong in our life. Feel sorry for yourself. You see, it's when you begin to realize how much you have in the Lord that you truly begin to be thankful. And when you're thankful, our hearts will abound with love for the Lord that He has so graciously given to all. An unthankful Christian is a defeated Christian for he or she has lost their joy. Number two, note the priority of gratitude, not just perception, but the priority. When he saw that he was healed, he turned around. The Lord had given the command to go to the priest, but he delayed following that command. He turned and he went back to the Lord. And why didn't Christ rebuke him for this? The reason is this: the man realized the priority of gratitude and worship. God has called his people, his church, to give glory to him above everything else. I believe that this man fully intended to obey what the Lord had told him to do, but he realized he had a higher calling that must be met first. If we don't give God thanks, it won't be long until our obedience just becomes a job to do. We lose the meaning of what God is wanting us to do. We become ungrateful. It's fitting and proper to give thanks and praise to the Lord for what he's done in our lives. And may I suggest that if we don't give God thanks, not only will it not be long until our obedience just becomes a job to do, but it won't be very long but what our obedience will become disobedience. Last of all, note the perfection of gratitude. Perception, priority, and perfection. As this man drew near where the Lord was, he glorified God. In the language of the day, it meant he made the Lord glorious. He manifested the worth of Christ. He came to Jesus and he fell down before him in perfect submission and he gave thanks. The Lord asked the question, wasn't there 10 cleansed? Where are the 9? I thought when you all yelled at me from 100 steps away that there were 10. I could almost hear Jesus saying, where's those 9 Jewish fellas? Notice what he said to the Samaritan. Arise. Go your way. Your faith has made you whole. Whole. There's a difference in being healed and being made whole. 9 got healed. 1 got made whole. And ladies and gentlemen, I would suggest to you today, if you have to choose between healing and wholeness, choose wholeness. Choose wholeness. Because wholeness has to do with the mind and the emotions and the will, not just this fleshly nature. It's the reason that Paul could write from a prison cell, I've learned in whatever situation I find myself to be content. Because though his body had been ravaged by beatings, he was still a man who was made whole by Jesus Christ. In a sense, gratitude is an expression of modesty. For in the Hebrew, the word for gratitude, hudea, is the same as the word for confession. To offer thanks is to confess dependence, to acknowledge that others have powers that will benefit us, to admit that our life is better because of their efforts. That frame of mind is indispensable to a healthy church and to a civilized society. Let me close. Never heard of this man before this week. When J.B. Fuqua was just a boy, someone offered him a helping hand. And he paid that helping hand back millions of times over for their kindness. J.B. grew up in rural Virginia in the years right after World War I. Those were lean times for a lot of people in the U.S. J.B. made up his mind at a very young age that someday he was going to be rich. But for a young man of very modest means and little opportunity, it would be difficult just for him to make ends meet. One thing caught J.B.'s fancy. It was learning to operate, Gene, a ham radio. But in order for a person to make a career in radio, he would have to be well-educated. And J.B. had no way to get a better education. One day, he learned that Duke University in North Carolina had a lending program in which people could check out library books by mail. J.B. began sending off for books on radio, on finance, on business, and on banking. He read everything that Duke University would send to him, and he taught himself everything there was to know about the radio business at that time. With this knowledge, J.B. opened his own radio station in Augusta, Georgia. Soon he added a second station. He began investing his money wisely. As his wealth grew, J.B. began buying and selling various businesses. He made his first $1 million by the age of 35. He then entered the political arena where he served in Georgia's House of Representatives. By 1970, Fuqua Industries was listed as a Fortune 500 company. And once he had achieved such incredible success, J.B. decided to give something back to the institution that helped him with his start. In 1980, J.B. made a gift of property and money to Duke University. In all, his donation was valued at $20 million. Not long afterwards, Fuqua convinced his friend Dave Thomas of Wendy's Restaurants to donate another $4 million to the school. Today, I'm told, if you visit Duke University, you will notice the business school is named the Fuqua School of Business. He never got a degree, but he never forgot where he got his books. No one at Duke could have known all those years ago that their decision to set up a lending library would have such an impact on anybody's life. And they never would have guessed how that kind gesture ever would have been repaid either. J.B. Fuqua was truly thankful for Duke University. When you are truly thankful for something, you want to do something in return. Only one of those 10 men that Jesus healed was truly grateful. And he returned to give Jesus thanks. And my guess, that one leper did something worthwhile with his life. Jesus Christ has done something rather incredible for every one of us. If we're grateful, he'll do something with our life. Let's pray. Our Father, we could be like a little boy and we could list a litany of things that we're grateful for. But I trust what we learn is it's that we remember to whom we are grateful for. And Father, you have given a great deal for us. For you gave to the world your one and only Son. That anyone who is part of this world could find your Son, and in finding your Son, we could find true life. In finding your Son, we could be delivered from the fortress of sin, and we could be delivered into the freedom of life in the Son. And Father, if there's a man or woman who's never experienced life in your Son, I trust today would be a great day for them to invite him to come be the Lord of their life. There's not a special prayer or a magic prayer. There's just an honest heart that says, Lord, I need someone bigger than myself, and I'm going to trust you. Father, for most of us in this room, we settled that bit of business a long time ago. But I wonder, under the leadership of your Holy Spirit today, which one of the two groups of men that we most identify with, the nine or the one? And Father, if it was the nine, I pray that there is repentance going on. And I trust there'll be a change in perception and a change in priority so that, Father, we worship you first of all. We thank you every day first of all. And then, Father, you will say to us, arise, go your way. Your life will be blessed. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you so much. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Amen. God bless you. Hope to see you back between 3 and 5:30.